Welcome to Understand the Math. This video is part of a series of videos on linear algebra and its applications and covers the second part of section 1.3 on the span of a set of vectors. I'll teach you all about the five topics listed here, and by the end of this video, you'll have a much better understanding of the concept of span in linear algebra. Be sure to check out the link below for free guided notes that you can highlight and fill in as you watch this video. Let's start by understanding how the span of a set of vectors is defined. Let's assume that we're given a set of vectors v1, v2, all the way up through vp in Rn. The span of this set of vectors is the set of all linear combinations of these vectors. We can write this mathematically as the span of v1 all the way up through vp is equal to c1 times v1 plus c2 times v2 all the way up through cp times vp. The right-hand side of this equation is all the linear combinations of these vectors and follows from what we learned about linear combinations in the video from section 1.3, part 1. Let's now look at an example where we're asked to find the span of two vectors. We're given v1 is equal to 1, 1, and v2 is equal to minus 1, 2. The span of v1 and v2 is all the linear combinations of these vectors, which is equal to c1 times 1, 1 plus c2 times minus 1, 2. This span is the plane shown here. This plane passes through the origin since C1 and C2 can both be set equal to 0. Let's now learn how to find other vectors that are in the span of a set of vectors. To find vectors that are in the span of a set of vectors, we'll write down what the span is and then choose values for the constants. Let's go through this example to see how to do this. We're given vectors v1 and v2 and asked to list three vectors in the span of v1 and v2. These are the same vectors we had in our previous example, and we saw that the span was equal to c1 times 1, 1 plus c2 times minus 1, 2. We can choose the first vector in this span to be the one that we get when we set c1 equal to 0 and when we set c2 equal to 0. This gives the vector 0, 0. Another vector can be when we set c1 equal to 0 and c2 equal to 2. This gives the vector minus 2, 4. Let's now do one where c1 and c2 are both non-zero. We can choose c1 to be 1 and c2 to be 1, and then we just have to add the two vectors and we get 0, 3. There are an infinite number of vectors that we could list that are in this span because C1 and C2 can be any value between minus infinity and infinity. Let's now talk about the geometric description of span. The span of a set of vectors can be described geometrically as a point, a line, or a plane through the origin. It can also be described as 3D space, 4D space, etc. We often need to state the dimension that the object is in, such as stating that we have a line in R3. Let's now look at five examples where we're given the span of a set of vectors and asked to give a geometric description of the span that includes the type of object and the dimension that the object is in. Our first example is to describe the span of the zero vector. This vector is located at the origin and is a point in R2 because our vector has two components and is in R2. Our second example is the span of the vector 1, 2. Our span is equal to C1 times our vector 1, 2. To visualize what the span is, let's draw the vector 1, 2. All linear combinations of this vector will lie along this line. This means that the span is a line in R2. Let's now look at the span of these two vectors. The span is equal to C1 times 1, 1 plus C2 times 3, 3. Notice that we can write the vector 3, 3 as 3 times the vector 1, 1. This gives us C1 times 1, 1 plus 3C2 times 1, 1. So we can write our span as C1 plus 3C2 times the vector 1, 1. This tells us that the span of this set of vectors is going to be all the linear combinations of 1, 1 and lie along this line. So just like in number 2, the span in example 3 also is a line in R2. Let's now look at our fourth example. This span is equal to C1, 1, 1 plus C2 minus 1, 2. This is the one that we had looked at previously. Let's go ahead and draw these vectors. We have our vector 1, 1, and then we have our vector minus 1, 2. One linear combination of these vectors will be when C1 is equal to 1 and C2 is equal to 1, and that's going to give us the vector 0, 3. Let's go ahead and draw that. Since C1 and C2 can be all values between minus infinity and infinity, there are an infinite number of vectors that we can draw. So the geometric description of this span is a plane in R2. In example 3, the two vectors in the span are multiples of each other, so the vectors are linearly dependent. The span of two linearly dependent vectors is a line. Let's contrast that to example 4. In example 4, the two vectors in the span are linearly independent. The span of two linearly independent vectors is a plane. Let's now see what the span of two linearly independent vectors in R3 looks like. We can visualize what this looks like in GeoGebra. The span of two linearly independent vectors is going to be a plane in R3. We're now going to go over the steps that we can follow to determine algebraically what the span of a set of vectors is. The first step is to construct a matrix whose columns are the vectors. The second step is to row reduce this matrix to echelon form. And then the third step is to count the number of pivots or linearly independent vectors. We'll use the vectors from example 4 above to see how this works. We'll place those vectors 1, 1, minus 1, 2 in a matrix and then reduce it to echelon form. Our echelon form looks like this. We have two pivots, and that tells us that we have two linearly independent vectors. And the span of these vectors is a plane in R2. And we'll often call this all of R2. I've made a chart that we're going to fill in that lists the number of linearly independent vectors or pivots on the left-hand side and the dimension of the vectors at the top. If we have one linearly independent vector in R2, the span of that vector is a line in R2. If we have two linearly independent vectors or pivots, the span is a plane in R2, which we saw on the previous example that we can call all of R2. Since we can't have more than two linearly independent vectors in R2, we'll put an X in these places. Let's now talk about vectors in R3. If we have one linearly independent vector in R3, the geometric description is a line in R3. Two linearly independent vectors or pivots gives us a plane in R3. I want to call your attention to the fact that this is not the same as R2. Students often make that mistake. When we have three linearly independent vectors in R3, our geometric description is called 3D space or all of R3. Since we can't have four linearly independent vectors in R3, we'll put an X here. Let's now look at R4. If we have one linearly independent vector in R4, the span is a line in R4. Two linearly independent vectors gives us a plane in R4. Three linearly independent vectors gives us what we call a 3D subspace of R4. We'll be talking about subspaces more later in this course. And then lastly, when we have four linearly independent vectors in R4, our geometric description is called 4D space or all of R4. Let's also note that the zero vector in R2, R3, R4, or higher dimensions is a point. Let's now walk through some example problems. In our first set of examples, we're asked to give a geometric description of the span that includes the type of object and the dimension that the object is in. In our first example, we're given three vectors, and they're all in R3. Following the steps on our previous page, we'll put these three vectors into a matrix. And we'll reduce it to echelon form. Skipping the steps, that form looks like this. Since we have two pivots, or two linearly independent vectors, the geometric description of our span is a plane in R3. This plane in R3 is formed by our vectors V1 and V2. To see how V3 can be written in terms of V1 and V2, we form the equation, written here in pink, and put our vectors into a matrix augmented with zero. We then put that matrix in reduced echelon form, circle our pivots, and solve for C1 and C2. We then put these values back into our equation, divide by C3, and we get a vector equation for V3 in terms of V1 and V2. This shows us that V3 is in the plane formed by V1 and V2. In our second example, we're given four vectors, and they're all in R4. We can notice, without even putting these vectors into a matrix, that we will have three pivots, or three linearly independent vectors. This tells us that the geometric description of the span of these four vectors is a 3D subspace of R4. The last topic that we'll talk about is to determine if one given vector is in the span of another set of vectors. In our example, we'll determine for what value or values of H is B in the plane spanned by A1 and A2. If B is in the plane spanned by A1 and A2, B will need to be a linear combination of A1 and A2. This means that our equation C1A1 plus C2A2 is equal to B needs to have a solution. To see for what values of H this equation will have a solution, we'll place A1 and A2 into a matrix and augment it with B. We'll then reduce the matrix to echelon form and find H so that a solution exists. Let's go ahead and do this. We'll put our vectors A1 and A2 in our matrix, and we'll augment our matrix with our vector B, which is 3, 1, H. We'll then put this matrix in echelon form, and I'm skipping those steps, and here's what we get. We'll have a solution if we set H minus 4 equal to 0. This gives us the solution H is equal to 4. When H is equal to 4, our vector B will be in the plane spanned by our vectors A1 and A2. Be sure to check out the next video in this series, where we'll learn all about matrix vector products and matrix equations. If this video has been helpful to you, please consider subscribing to my channel. Keep believing in yourself and have a great rest of your day.